Britain's spring fly fishing show. It's a great honour to be sat here with Hans. And Hans, it's and how's the show going, Hans?
I just had a marvellous show there. It was completely packed with people.
Yeah.
So I was completely amazed because I did it last year and the year before,
yeah,
the same, and it's still packed.
So come on, Hans, give us a little bit of life history. Come on.
So I started fly fishing at the age of 15. It's actually a nice story because my mother was always ill. And I was very independent because,
yeah,
I take care about my two sisters.
Yeah.
And when I was 15, I went with my parents to Norway.
Yeah.
And they had a house in the southern part of Norway. They rented a house there, and in the center of Norway.
Yeah.
So because I was so independent, I wanted to do a little bit more than just stay with my parents.
Yeah.
So I asked my father, a little tent, if it was possible to go from the south to the middle. By myself.
Yeah.
And he allowed. You know, my mother was actually she was actually the one who said, okay, let's do it.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was my first holiday, 2 weeks on my own. And then I got involved in fly fishing. I got my father's old cane rod with me, terrible rod, terrible,
yeah,
conditions. The reel was terrible, the line was terrible. And I was camping out the river Lag in the center of Norway, and then there was two girls fishing, and they were fishing with a fly,
yeah,
and I was with a terrible equipment, so we got chatting and we got in contact. I mean, 15 years, stranger, foreigner. What happened was, finally they one of the girls worked in a tackle shop, so she brought a rod for me,
yeah,
and a reel and some flies and give me a little bit basic lessons, and that's how I started. And then when after 2 weeks, I stayed there almost 2 weeks,
yeah,
and then after I left, they gave me a rod, the other one gave me a reel and a box of flies,
yeah,
and that's actually how it all started.
Well,
and,
I'll be.
So when I was 16, I went on my own, take an interrail. I went to Scandinavian again. I go always doing everything,
yeah,
with fishing and hiking and doing all of myself.
So when did you actually start producing your own flies?
It was 1976. Yeah, then I started fly tying, and it was a disaster.
Was
complete
it?
Disaster. Yeah, there were no books available. I didn't know what to do. I even didn't know how to wrap a hackle. I couldn't find a clue.
So we were really back to basics.
Yeah, back to basics. Until I found a book, tiny little handbook from Sutherland or something like that. Three people wrote the book. Tiny little pockets.
Yeah.
And there were the basics in it.
Yeah.
And then I figured, I saw the light, I started to do it. And then,
so one or two experiments came along.
Yeah. And so finally the red deck was okay, and simple flies, but Greenwell's Glories and all those stuff. And then I got a contact in the place where I live, and the guy tried to get some pattern books for me, just pattern dressings,
yeah,
and nothing,
sure,
else.
Yeah.
And then I start to buy patterns and cut them and figure out how to,
yeah,
get together.
So come on, the fly that you're famous for is a what? What's the name of your most famous fly?
That's the Klinken special. Yeah.
And that's renowned now, is it? And people,
yeah,
around the world,
yeah,
know that.
It's fishing from the Falklands, New Zealand.
So come on then. Let us into a secret. When did you first produce that fly?
In 1984, I was. Actually, I came on a camping where I always stay in
yeah.
Norway, and then a Swedish friend of mine just left when we came. So he stopped, go, shake hands, and,
yeah,
but he had to go because there was some family problems, somebody died or something. And the only thing he said, Hans, if you want to succeed this year, you have to fish in the surface film. Just do it deep, you know, because they don't come up, they don't come for dry flies. So what I did in the when I went fishing, I take a red tag, just put it in my mouth, you know, and fish it wet on the, just on the surface.
Yes.
And then I got few good fish. So this trick really, this tip was very, very important for me.
Yeah.
So I took two fish for dinner because we camp out in the wilderness.
Yeah, sure.
It's nothing against that, you know. So I cleaned the stomach and checked out, and I was a huge caddis, you know.
Was
very,
it?
Very big. And it was curved, you know, and I said, wow. And I was checking, and the only hook I had was a big K2B Fortis grip hook.
Right.
Yorkshire set hook or something like that.
Yeah.
Real big. But the whole caddis fit exactly on that hook.
Right, so that there was the bait. Is
yeah, that? So that I tied it on, and then I tied it as a parachute because I wanted to have it deep.
You're right.
As my friend said.
Yeah.
And put on calf tail as first as wing, which wasn't a good idea because I changed it later on for a poly yarn to get it folded better. But that actually how it happened. And yeah. The first prototype was ready. The tent was there, the Bloma River in front of the tent.
Yeah.
I did the first cast, I didn't know what happened. I got 48 centimeter railing in the port of river where everybody fished. And then another cast, I got six fish right away. Six cast, six fish.
Really?
No get off. I said, wow, God, what's this?
So there you knew you had a winner. You knew
yeah,
you had a winner.
I knew it directly. This is something.
And from there on in, it's been used all around the world and fantastic report.
Yeah, I improved it first. Improved the pattern to give it a last final touch with peacock curl and with a different wing.
Yeah.
And I found a solution with a combination of daily wax to floatant and yarn.
Yeah.
So I had a perfect combination. And what happened then? I was fishing like crazy because I was in the army in Germany.
Right.
A lot of spare time.
Yeah.
And so I went up 7-8 times a year to Norway and Sweden for fishing. But then in 1986, I came. I was fishing with Ian Small from the Grayling Society in the Wells Dee, and I saw that broken water, a big riffle. There was some people fishing there. And I said, this water is need my fly. So yeah. I put on a size 8 in a well steer, size 8 Klinken, put it in a riffle, and my God, it goes mad.
Does
I
it?
Got fish after fish. First grayling, trout, and I got even 3 sea trout.
Really?
And on the other side of the river, there was, I mean, I think at the height of the success, there was probably 13, 14 people watching me.
Goodness,
they couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
And then John Roberts heard the story, he invites me for fishing, Malcolm Greenholz invites me, Oliver Edwards, and we all go fishing, they all want to fish with
yeah,
see
yeah.
what happens.
Yeah.
I amaze them all, and then they start to write about it, and fish with it, and give it to friends. And then Hans de Groot, in the same year, I wrote a story for a Dutch fly fishing magazine.
Yeah.
And the name of the fly was actually the LT Caddis.
Right.
It was number 7 of a series of 44 flies I made in Norway in the 80s, and which was a terrible name. And I was, when I wrote the story, it was a good story about fly fishing in Norway. I was upset from the editorial staff meeting,
yes.
where we did all with cutting and putting together all the
yeah.
stuff, you know. More fun, whiskey and all the stuff. But very, very unprofessionally, but a lot of fun, you know.
Yeah,
and
sure.
We put the magazine together. But I wasn't there. And then they wanted to tease me a little bit, and they changed the name. So my name is Klinken.
Yeah.
So they started to think something with Klink in it. They wanted to give it a Norwegian expression or impression. And then they came with Hammer, but with a big O on the E, you know? And so that's how the Klinken special was born. And the name was given actually by Hans de Groot and Ton Lindhout. And so when I read the story, what the hell is That's my fly. Oh, that's a nice name, you know.
Well, Hans, that's a fantastic story. Thank you very much indeed for spending time with UK Game Fairs Magazine. Hope all goes well at the show, and we'll no doubt see you soon. Thank you, Hans. Much obliged. Thank you.